thinking of speaking to a physics audience, so I gave a title which is kind of physics-y. But then Dima convinced me to change the talk. So this will be a highly experimental talk, despite the fact that I'll only talk about theory mostly. And so my name is Alex Koulakov. If you don't know me, I'm at Colesmith Harbour Lab, and I'm a computational neuroscientist slash theorist. My talk will have two halves. And the largest half will be I'll be talking about low dimensionality of perceptive olfactory space, whatever it means, and I'll just try to convince you, maybe bring you to the camp that the number of dimensions in olfaction is low. And then the second half, I'll try to basically marry the primacy model with the low dimensionality and see if there are some testable predictions of that fusion of theories. And so the main hypothesis, so there are basically two viewpoints, I think, that could be formulated, which are diametrically opposite. And one of them is that the number of olfactory dimensions is the same as the number of, roughly the same, of the same order of magnitude, hundreds, maybe thousands dimensions. So for each receptor would correspond to a significant fraction of a dimension. And the second viewpoint is that the number of dimensions, whatever it means, we'll try to define it later, is much lower than the number of receptors. I have to start the timer. Okay. So the reason why I will basically talk about, try to convince you that hypothesis two is true is, I think, twofold. One of them is, one of the reasons is cynical, and it's not really scientific. It's that if the hypothesis number one is true, then, one of those buttons is a light. Yeah. How many theories does it take to figure out? So, if the number of dimensions is high, so basically it will take us a lot of time to figure it out. Probably not in my lifetime. So my only hope to figure out how olfaction works is that the hypothesis number two is true. It's, I mean, the same hypothesis of suggestion of Freeman Dyson to look for extraterrestrial life in a solar system, right? Because otherwise we have no chance to find it. So the second probably is more scientific is that, I mean, the experiments, there is apparently enormous redundancy in the olfactory system. The olfactory perception can sustain tremendous, is very robust to lesions, right? So if we remove a large number of receptors, we more or less retain the same ability to smell. And I mean, that kind of suggested that there are more than one receptor per dimension, per olfactory dimension. Because if you knocked out one receptor, and there would be important impairments in the percept. So I'll try to basically convince you that hypothesis two has at least legitimacy, some legitimacy. And I'll start from some old study, and I apologize for you that that we did some years ago, and just as an introduction to this topic. So this is based on this data set, which Noam actually brought to our attention, and I'd like to thank him for that, which was published as a book by Andrew Dravniks. There were already two talks, I think, about it in this meeting. So it's basically a book by Andrew Dravniks, which contains pages. Each page is dedicated, it contains tables. Each table is dedicated to individual odorant. Most of the odorants are monomolecular, and this particular example is heptanol, and there is a list of words on the page, and there are 146 words, and the numbers that you see is percent of people out of army of observers that recognize that this word applies to this smell. So it's averaging over a large number of people, about 150 people per smell, and so therefore this basically represents a snapshot of olfaction in a communist society where everybody has the same sense of smell. So, but probably like start understanding olfaction in the communist society is a good start. And then we'll try to figure out what the diversities are. And of course, like as Noam described, I mean, the first compelling thing that you can do with this is to put it in PCA space, in principal component space, which we did. And if you spin it, so what we noticed is if you spin this cloud of points, each dot here represents individual molecule. And those are principal component space that the dimensions which Noam described. So you will see that they occupy, if you look from certain direction, you will see that they cluster around some curved manifold that looks like letter C. So we thought that maybe this is, we need to, instead of principal component analysis, we need to embed the molecules in a more curved space. So because principal component analysis approximates the molecules with the flat spaces. So that we did. So we actually invented a new technique for doing it, which is basically fitting the cloud of points with the polynomial second degree surfaces, which you can see here. So we call this surface potato chip, just because of the resemblance. And the way how you find the parameters of this surface is that you see that those lines, those red lines, connect the odorants with the nearest points on the surface, and you minimize the total squared length of those lines. And after you figure out, I mean, this is the same surface shown in from two directions. After you optimize the parameters of the surface, you will see that it's in 146 dimensions. Here you only see three dimensions. Well, you actually see two, but it's in three dimensions. So, but in the entire 146 dimensional semantic space, this two-dimensional manifold, two-dimensional potato chip captures about 50% of data. So that was compelling to us and somewhat surprising. So what are the two dimensions that are on the you can find on the surface? And one of the dimensions, I mean, you can basically judge what the dimensions are to some degree by looking at the words which have semantic descriptors that have high positive and negative loadings along certain dimensions. So for example, the vertical dimension, you can just look that it's, you can just see that this is associated with pleasantness, and this is consistent with Noam's findings, of course. So the other dimension is more subtle. So I have no semantic skill, so I just ask people. I pulled a bunch of opinions of what it may mean. And of course, I mean, the meaning of the second dimension is somewhat anecdotal, right? So we actually have the complete definition of the dimension of the computer. So, but if you want to label it with something, it's kind of fun to do. So some people suggest that it's edibility, because there are some things which are edible here, but there's also some things which are not really nasty. But other people say that it's related to kitchen, so it's probably there's burnt stuff. The craziest suggestion I got from John Lisman, that it's related to auditory pitch. So only John Lisman could actually have made this suggestion. So because, like, if you look at the words which are on the right and the words which are on the left, you could associate them with things which are different in auditory pitch. Right? But, like, probably the most compelling idea for what the second dimension means is trying to correlate it with properties of the molecules. We also know the properties of the molecules, which you compute some computational chemistry packages. And we find that a lot of properties which are related to hydrophobicity or polarity of the molecules, such as water of hydration or the Debye dipole moment, they are correlated with, not strongly, but it's very narrow correlation with the second dimension. So those are the two dimensions which we find in the data set, and they capture about 50%. When we include the curvature of the surface. But then we thought that why limit ourselves with two dimensions? So Dimo suggested that we go to higher, regress to higher dimensions. We have to do it carefully because we want to be because the number of parameters will increase, so we actually have to do cross-validation and make sure control the parameters, make sure that we don't overfit. So this is actually included variance after cross-validation. So it never can go to 100%. It goes to about 80%. So what you can see here is that the two-dimensional data set, the potato chip, which I described before, captures a little bit over 50% of variance after cross-validation. And but the three-dimensional potato chip, which we call potato, captures somewhat more. And then when we go to a hyperspud of about seven dimensions, we get to basically it asymptotes at about 80% of variance. But we can also do some other tricks, such as we can estimate the residual amount of noise. Even after using 150 observers, there's still some degree of noise present in the data set. So that's our estimate. So we cannot explain only 12% of the data set after cross-validation. Also interestingly, the data set contains mixtures. So we can test, we can figure out the hyperspud for the curved manifold for monomolecular odorants, and then test mixtures, try to see how far mixtures are from that hyperspud. That we did, and that's the curve for the 15 mixtures which are present there in the same data set. And what is interesting is that low levels of variance, there is a one mixtures actually require one extra dimension to be explained, which you could call a mixture dimension. It's interesting that you can actually, with some precision, you can identify whether the percept belongs to a mixture or not from the data set. So you can actually use this extra dimension to classify odorants into mixtures or monomolecular odorants. And then when you go to high levels of variance or of precision, the difference between space of mixtures and the space of monomolecular odorants disappears. For example, the seven-dimensional data set already includes both mixtures and the monomolecular smells. So that for us was a motivation basically to try to find some other examples of low-dimensional representation. I guess the key thing here in this data set is that it's curved. So the idea is that, I guess what is suggested by this data is that the richness of olfactory perception emerges from the fact that the sensory manifold is curved. So as you proceed, although the number of parameters that determine the position of an odorant in this sensory manifold is small, it's maybe close to 10, as you move along the manifold, the percepts will vary dramatically because of its curved nature. So maybe the richness of olfactory percepts is illusory as a result of this curvature. Yeah. Oh, it's very interesting. They actually cluster. So there is a pole of pleasantness and the pole of unpleasantness. And this is the pole of pleasantness. Unfortunately, it's at the bottom. I just put it to bait people into asking me this. So you see that the smells actually cluster along the pleasantness pole, and there is some clustering along on the pole of unpleasantness. But in the middle, there's another interesting thing is that this potato chip, it expands in the middle, which means that if the smells is neither pleasant nor unpleasant, probably people spend more time in describing it. So, yeah. So this probably, the clustering, it's not clear whether it's real or it's just produced by sample of the smells that they used, which emerges from flavor industry. Yep. Yeah, there is nothing. There is nothing. I mean, we did, of course, did it. Yeah. Huh? Or you would need about 50. Yeah. I mean, it's basically this curve will be flat. You will not see any. It will go like this. Yeah. Of course, we randomized it. Yep. Do I have explanation? I mean, I guess it's a mixture. I would call it mixture dimension. Again, we have it in the computer. I'll try to show you. I mean, there isn't much I can extract from the semantic descriptors. I was prepared for this question. But I have to. Oh, I have to go through all the talk. And now you all saw it, so. Oh. That's the slide, the mixture dimension. So basically there are words which are suggestive of like increased complexity. And the interesting thing is, again, you can actually discriminate. You can look at the smell, look at this, the descriptors of the smell, and you can tell with 70% chance for the balanced data set, so it's 20% above chance, you can tell whether this person belongs to a mixture of monomeric or smell, which I find funny because I, probably not many people can tell what this, whether they smell monomeric or smell mixture. But those are the sets of words. I mean, we call it a mixture dimension just for the lack of better description. Sorry, I have to go back.
I have a just a favor to ask. So we have this data set that I talked about a couple of days ago. We have 496 photos.
We have a two, yeah.
So that will fill in the valence space because many of them are have no nails. So what if you run your analysis on that?
We're running it right now, yeah. It's like it takes us some time. It's just there's so many smells. Also, I mean, it's a bit different format from the Dravnik's dataset because you have only 19, I think, descriptors and you know fewer people, so some care has to be taken about statistics.
But principally, I'm curious to see if it will work.
Yeah, yeah.
Because many of the 146 descriptors you might use.
Yeah. We run a very exhaustive, basically semantic analysis on this with doing Google searches. I mean, I don't know if you saw it. There is an appendix to our paper where we run Google searches with the words. So we find actually using bag of words approximation, which is like one of the basic approximations in semantics, we find that there are about 60 dimensions in just the words. So I think the appropriate choice for the number of set of words is about 60. In olfactory background, so if you find the web pages with Google with olfactory background, you find that number of dimensions will be close to 50. So, but also each of those dimensions is a mixed dimension, so probably it will include several words from the Dravnik's data. But even with your data set, because it has so many smells, it's very compelling, of course. So the next thing I would like to talk about is olfactory genome. So if there is this low dimensionality, maybe it has imprint in olfactory genes. So this is just a general introduction of how many genes we have, and the empty spaces are pseudogenes and the full are genes. I mean, these are the data that we have. We downloaded it from Doran Lancet's database. So what you can do is you can compute, for example, a distance matrix for different olfactory genes, which is the number of substitutions that you have to, that different sequences contain in amino acids. So this is an example of such table for humans. And then you can try to do PCA analysis on this data. And it comes up with very interesting pictures that you can see here. So those are genes. Also, Doran Lancet published a paper where he described olfactory genome, which has a very similar picture with this three-legged structure structure includes, in our analysis, both genes and pseudogenes. The pseudogenes were fixed by an algorithm which Doran Lancet developed. So you can see there are a lot of empty dots, which are pseudogenes, which we also include. So it has this beautiful three-legged structure, which was compelling and interesting for us. So we thought about it. And then one of the things which was a real bummer is the including dimensionality, just to show you the negative result so that we don't cheat. You know that we don't cheat. So if you look at the included variance in this PCA analysis of the genes, as a number of dimensions, you see that there is like an 80% variance is reached at 300 dimensions. So there is. So if you look at this, apparently the number of dimensions in the sequences of olfactory receptors is enormous. It's hundreds, right? So that was a real bummer for us. And then we look at the entire sequence, we looked at binding sites. It turns out that there is an enormous redundancy in the sequence. So you can actually get the same picture if you cut out the random subsequence. So there's apparently coevolution in different positions in the receptor. But if you just look at the binding sites, you will see a very similar structure, except it will be less well-defined. It will be a bit puffier. So that was interesting. That was disappointing. Yeah, because there are legs coming out in more than three dimensions. So they stick out in a lot of dimensions, which I cannot show you. But this picture just quantifies that. So, but then I'm not going to show you this, but I managed to generate exactly the same picture from random data. After staring at this for a few years, I managed to, in MATLAB, write a program of 5 lines that generates exactly the same picture, so I actually realized what is wrong with it. And what is wrong with it is that the distance matrix, which is measured in the number of substitutions, doesn't really replicate the functional distances between genes. So what if you just take a cloud of points and you compute distances between points, and then you compute an exponential function of that distance, you will find a very similar structure to this. So that meant to me that actually the large distances are probably not correctly reproduced by just the number, or not correctly captured by the number of substitutions and amino acids. So probably if you see two OR genes which differ by two or one substitution, they're very close to each other in this genetic space, but if there are more than one substitution, you probably have a completely wrong idea about how far they are. And fortunately, yeah. Well, we use different matrices. We use the multiple sequence alignment, aligning all genes to each other, to this common frame. And but this particular result is obtained by just pairwise alignment, which is probably most precise. Yep.
So I think the pair, the so-called
phylogenetic tree doesn't have dimension. I mean, it will capture, it will have the similar, like families, for example. You can see that families, this is family 7, which is almost entirely dead in humans, I think. I mean, those families are derived from phylogenetic analysis. So they actually are, they cluster out in this PCA space. I'm just trying to... there is a, I mean, these are pseudogenes, which are fixed by Doran's algorithm. They have very small, they have like point mutations, such as frame shifts or some nonsense. No, those are not included.
Because those were included.
Well, they were? I looked at the alignments. They look very nice, actually.
I mean, we're talking 2001, so...
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, the alignment that I looked at, like multiple sequence alignment, is very nice. It's actually on our website. I mean, you can check it out. So there is no pieces there. There is no half gene. So the hypothesis was that the long distances are messed up, but probably short distances or short, that the fact that the genes have small number of substitutions between each other, it's not so irrelevant. So fortunately for us, there was actually an algorithm which was developed in 2000, which deals with exactly this problem, which is called ISOMAP. ISOMAP, what it does, it ignores the long distances. So this is an example of ISOMAP algorithm run on a surrogate data set, which is called Swiss roll, where you have a set of data, and they say that obviously these distances are not, because the relevant dimension, it's a two-dimensional set of points, right? So these distances are wrong, but the distances in between nearest points are probably correct. So what ISOMAP does, it attempts to compute the long distance, it ignores the long distance information and only takes the short distances, and then recomputes long distances via the short distances using what they call geodesics, which are the shortest distances on the Swiss roll, right? So this algorithm is capable of unrolling the Swiss roll. To say so, So basically, it's capable of recovering the long-distance information from just nearest neighbor or short-distance information. So we use this alignment or distance matrix for, this actually includes both humans and mice. And after running isomap on it, we find with here, I think humans are blue and mice are red. We find that if you run the isomap analysis, then the actual number of dimensions is not so large. It's probably close to 10 to capture 90% of variance. Also, there are some limitations to isomap algorithm, which don't allow it to approach 100% because it only uses flats. It can only unfold the flat space. It cannot unfold something which has curvature to it, which is one of the possible directions of extending it. How much time do I have? Okay. So that's basically another evidence, I think, or motivation for us to look at olfactory space as a low dimensional. Of course, the really interesting question is, if this is true, if genetic space, the space of receptor sequences is low dimensional, how do you align it with the perceptual space? That would be very interesting. And probably more data in that direction, if there is like some kind of matrix which relates receptors to molecules, to ligands, which is more extensive than already exists in the literature, would be useful in that. So I would like to move along to the primacy coding for the second half of my talk. And the question will be, what would be the evolutionary model for olfactory receptors, which would be generated by the primacy model, which Dima described yesterday. And I'll remind you what the primacy model is. So this is my experimental slide of the talk, which is stolen from Tom Boza's paper. So those are the patterns of activation of glomeruli on just by different smells. And this is the theorist's view on this same picture, the circular spherical glomeruli with the activation different other identities will be produced by different combination patterns. As you increase the concentration of an odorant, you recruit more glomeruli. So the question, of course, is how is it possible that we link those two different concentrations into a single odor quality? And according to the primacy idea, which Dima introduced yesterday, we only look at the glomeruli which have strongest activation levels. And those remain approximately invariant over a range of concentrations. So that's the idea for at least within some range of concentrations, how perceptual invariance for odorants can be generated. So different odorants, of course, will be represented by a different primacy glomeruli. And the important parameter of this hypothesis is the number of primacy glomeruli, which is, in this case, 2, we estimate from Dima's data that for mice, it's somewhere between 15 and 20. But it's still less than the number of receptors. So the primacy model suggests that small number of receptors activated first or activated at the highest level represent odorant identity in a concentration invariant manner. So now we would like to ask a question. What are the signatures of primacy coding mechanism in the responses of olfactory receptors and potentially in the sequences of olfactory receptors? I mean, it has to have some imprint in those things. So, and I hope I convinced you that the olfactory space is low dimensional. So we have those primary, or let's call them basic smells, which I call here odor X and odor Y for two-dimensional. I mean, you can think about it, for example, as dimensions on the potato chip, azimuth and elevation. So they are not related to individual smells or molecules. They probably, but I'll treat them as individual molecules. So they're probably mixtures. So the receptor, like each olfactory receptor, could be defined by a binding constant, by binding affinity to those two smells. So it's each receptor is a point in this two-dimensional space defined by binding affinity to order X and order Y. So this would be the second receptor, and the ensemble of olfactory receptors is a cloud of points in this space. So when order X is present, and as the concentration of order X increases, it will at some point, it will divide the plane, this two-dimensional plane, into the zone of active receptors and inactive receptors, the ones which are above C50 or below C50. And as the concentration of odorant is increased, more and more receptors get recruited, and at some point, those two receptors will be recruited the earliest, or they will be activated at the highest level, right? So the receptor, those two receptors will be representing, this tuplet of receptors will be representing the identity within the primacy mechanism, the identity of order X. And similarly, in as I increase the concentration of order Y, it will sweep the plane, and it will activate those two receptors at the highest level, at which point it will be represented, the representation of order Y will be formed as the pair of those two receptors. So if you form a mixture of order X and Y, a different pair, the plane will propagate, as you increase the concentration of the mixture, the plane will propagate, will sweep through the surface from infinity, and it will activate those, the other set of two receptors. And that's the representation of mixture of order X and Y within the primacy model. Similarly, there are other mixtures possible. There is this mixture, and there's like this very subtle mixture coming at a very narrow angle here, which, believe me, this point actually, this segment is very important to me as a mathematician, because it argues that this set of, you see, this is the complete repertoire of identities for this set of receptors. So this set of receptors can represent five order identities. And one of those order identities is represented by this thing sticking out of the surface, which means that it's not the it's not just a convex hull of the set of points. There are the more, there's more complexity to this. So the order identities are not just given by a convex hull of the set of receptors. They're also given by some hair that grows inside the surface. Right? So we call this hull, instead of convex hull, we call it a primacy hull. Because the definition of this, it's a mathematical object, which is defined as you basically sweep planes through the you sweep boundaries through the plane at different angles, and then you activate P points at some point. You sweep through P points, and that's when you define, that's when you put a segment there. Well, that's exact mathematical. So it's a new mathematical object. That's what I'm trying to say. It's not a convex hull, which I find very interesting, that like biology can actually generate new mathematical objects. Yeah, yeah, but you could imagine that, for example, the set of order identities would be given by a convex hull,
yeah.
But this little thing sticking out argues that it's not. It's more complex thing. There are actually more identities that can be given than by a convex hull. So, but it also means that there is reduced evolutionary pressure on the receptors within the hull because they represent nothing, so they should be eliminated, right? So, which is in principle a testable prediction. So this simple model suggests that, you know, the receptors, they occupy a narrow manifold in the parameter space, in the binding affinity space, and we could try to test that. Interestingly, if you have primacy numbers more than two, I described you the primacy model with just two receptors identifying an order. You can have more, then you have, each receptor will be represented by a face on this hull, which is, for p equal 3, it's a triangle, for p equal 4, it's a tetrahedron, and generally it's a simplex, right? So this is an example of primacy hull in three dimensions with primacy number three, so each other identity is given by a triangle. So this is a more complex example. Unfortunately, I have to project it to 3D. It's also a hull, it's a five-dimensional, or close to five-dimensional hull, in six dimensions, I have to show it in its immense, right? So, yeah. Yes, they should not be there. They should become pseudogens. That's the idea. No, I didn't say that. I mean, I'm not sure. You mean if you increase the concentration, you have a granular which have low affinity to the smell. The question is if they are activated at the higher level. I don't think I've said that. I think Dima has some data. I'm not sure if he showed it yesterday. I just don't remember. Which shows that. Of mitral cells, you see an increase, and I think you then later you see a decrease. I think there is some imaging data on that. And some glomeruli show actually a slight decrease, but I think it's due to feedback. It's due to basically presynaptic feedback that they receive. Yes. So they shift earlier in the SNF cycle, and they slightly increase the firing rate. But the most interesting thing is they shift earlier. So they actually two. I guess you're asking the right question because there are two ways to formulate the primacy model. One is in time domain, that the earliest ones activated are the primary ones. Another one is the strongest activated are primary ones. And I'm just simplifying things but there, those two formulations are related because, like, if a mitral cell receives a stronger drive from the receptor, it will be both early activated and more strongly activated. Right, so this is an example, very confusing example of a seven-dimensional. Well, each odorant per sep will be a P7 a simplex containing seven points, right? Seven points connected all to all. So you can actually test whether the primacy hull exists in this hull. If you notice that primacy hull is actually a surface, so the simplices, they tessellate a surface, they're close to a surface. So they have a lot of nearest neighbors. A lot of simplices are basically touching each other, right? So if you just randomize, if you pull the simplices randomly from the same set of points, you can generate an artificial cloud of points, like random resampling of the data, and you will find that the number of nearest neighbors will be smaller in this artificially resampled. And that's how you can detect the fact that this mass contains a surface. Okay? So, for example, in this... Huh? Well, thank you. Appreciate it. I hope you're not being sarcastic. I guess you can see this. I mean, this is one of the ways, and I apologize if it's a bit confusing. One of the ways to see it, so this is basically the number of simplices that share certain overlap, right? And this is These are seven simplices, though. So each odorant identity is seven receptors, right? And those are the nearest neighbors. They share a face, which is a six-point face, right? And you see that in random data set, the number of those, this is a blue is a resampled data set by just randomly pulling simplices. The number of nearest neighbors is reduced compared to the primacy hull, which suggests that this mass contains a primacy hull, right? So I can, this is a testable prediction. The prediction that the existence of primacy hull becomes testable. So, for example, how can you test it? You can look at if you have a response matrix, when you have responses of glomeruli for different odorants, and this is just the example that I show. The numbers here are example number of spikes emitted by a given glomerulus or given receptor to an odorant. And I've marked with red, I marked the primary receptors for each odorant. So for this odorant, you see 9, 7, and 8. They have strongest responses. So it's PCL3 model. Each odorant identity is given by a triangle. So there are a bunch of odorants. They have, I mean, I'm hoping this is interesting. This is understandable. If not, please ask.
Can I just, the thing that I find so clever about this is you come up with a way to test. So your model's formulated in terms of binding affinity to each receptor for each one of your dimensions in space, right?
Yeah.
You might naively think you couldn't test the model unless you had all the functional data.
Yeah. No, I can use the functional data, which...
Well, yeah, you can definitely use functional data, right? But you can also just use genomic data, right?
Yes.
You predict the modifications to follow the same structure as this, right?
Yeah.
How do you understand this? The empirical data from Matsunami and Mayman shows that a little sniff that you never predict the destroyed receptor, often destroyed receptor, functional. It's not easy to go from the primary reaction to the side. Oh, if that's functional, not. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And often the reference genome, the most prevalent allele with the highest allele frequency in the population is non-functional.
Mm-hmm.
It's just another complexity. I know
Yeah. I mean, I tend to reduce complexity to before I increase it,
yeah.
But it doesn't make me happy. I mean, I guess I'm becoming a biologist, so. So then what you can define this, what they call a simplex matrix, which tells you which receptors, it basically switch matrix, which tells you puts ones at the places for primary receptors for a given smell. So this is one smell, those three receptors are primary, right? And in this matrix, so given a response matrix of receptors or glomeruli, you can find the primary receptors, obviously. That's what I'm saying, trivial thing. But then you can also find the nearest neighbors. Like, for example, these two lines, they're obviously nearest neighbors because they share two receptors in primacy model 3, right? So this is just the geometric interpretation of what you see here. So two receptor number 2, 3, and 5, 2, 3, and 5 is involved in this smell, and this smell is represented by 3, 5, and 7. So you see that they're nearest neighbors. Right? So if only I had the response data to test this, I could actually run the analysis of nearest neighbors. Yeah?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I mean, I love that, you know, you're looking at all these different ways mm-hmm. with the data and interpretive
type of way. And it would be great
if you could, if you had some way to test the model.
Yeah. I mean,
you know,
my
there's
test...
This is a great idea.
Yeah.
Now we can go back.
Right. I mean, I guess what you mean is if you... Yeah, I mean, I have data which is not probably going to convince you fully. I mean, I guess what I would like to see is some kind of functional test where you modify the percept by stimulating glomeruli. Yeah, yeah. But the test which I'm proposing is just statistical. So we actually have Hallemann-Carlson data, which was published some years ago. It's exactly what I need, right? So it has the receptor responses with their firing rates to the odorant, and I can generate this simplectic matrix, and then I can run a nearest neighbor analysis, and that's what my student did. So for primacy number 5, I mean, this is fly data, right? You indeed see in the resampled data, you see a reduced number of nearest neighbors. The p-value is significant, and there is, for p equals 7, 6, you have even more significance. So there is suggestion, at least correlational, I guess, it's not really causal, that there is some signature, there is some hull. So there are correlations in the response data. So the response data is not a random matrix. There are correlations, and the correlations are consistent with the primacy model existing in loading number of dimensions. Yes. It increases. The significance increases both in surrogate data set and in real data set. I guess the first, what we find is the first P at which you have significance is the P which you are looking for.
But you don't lose this effect if you go to larger numbers.
No. Yeah. This bump? So this is basically the number of nearest neighbors. It's the number of selves. It's when you have nearest neighbor of highest level with yourself. And the number of your nearest neighbors is smaller than the number of selves. And that's why you see resampling doesn't change this number, because resampling doesn't change the number of percepts. If I vary the number of receptors, so I vary P. Well, as you increase, we can compute, there are some theoretical results which are very interesting to us. Obviously, we're theorists, so that's what we breathe, math. So. We can actually compute the number of percepts that you have as a function of P and the number of receptors. And there's a very interesting formula, which is the number of percepts is P factorial times number of receptors, which gives you hundreds of millions, like for realistic estimate for what human. So it's P factorial times N. I mean, you could think that it's a binomial. You can think that it's a binomial coefficient, but it's more interesting because the geometry of this random primacy hull is very interesting. So these are the conclusions. So we predict that there are high order correlations, which you can actually test. So I'd like to, I have how much time? -3? Oh, okay. Oh, I have plenty of, like 20 minutes. So I'd like to basically talk now about the models, the network models at those. Yep. You'll have a statistical result. I mean, even this data is a subset. I should say that. So this is one of the confounding issues. There are only 24 receptors here, because they can only. I mean, I think it's an ectopic receptor that they put in the cell where receptor was knocked in, the endogenous receptor was knocked in. So then they can only put in 24 receptors. Even this. Yeah. Even this one is like maybe like a half of the receptors, a bit more than a half. So it basically reduces our statistical power. That's what it does. So then I would like to talk about network models. So how can you process primacy? And this is like the simplest possible network, just coincidence detector, that you can suggest that in piriform cortex or in mushroom body, there would be cells which are listening to individual simplices, to triangles that I presented to you before. So when this triple of cells is activated, they become primary, and they will drive this piriform cortical or mushroom body canyon cell. And it will, for example, inhibit all others, so there will be winner takes it all. Or you could have like multiple cells representing multiple faces of a primacy, simplex. Also, so, but the idea is that the connectivity in between the primary sensory area, such as olfactory bulb and antennal lobe, will contain that information about primacy half. Right, so we can also formulate, therefore we can formulate, if we know that there are correlations in the layout of only some subsets of receptor activations are relevant to the animal, maybe there are some correlations in the connectivity, and the correlations have to be very high order, right? Because they will involve, the correlations will involve combinations which are P, right, which are P receptors. So it's not so straightforward to actually see them in the connection matrix. So if we have a connection matrix, I hope it's clear. If we had a connection matrix, we could run the same test that I showed you before. If we had a, right, just assuming that elements of connection matrix, they're vertices, right? I should say that this is, each individual receptor is a vertex in the simplex, and each cell becomes a simplex. And the connections are connections, they indicate which vertex belongs to which simplex. If only I had data, and fortunately to us, recently the data was published by the group in Janelle Farm, which shows larval connectivity from antenna lobe to mushroom body. So Albert Cardona actually was kind enough to give us this data before it was published, so we had some time to data crunch. And we run the same analysis on this data. This shows actually a connection matrix, number of synapses from 25 projection neurons. But in this analysis, we only use 22. I mean, I'm sorry, this is more complete connection matrix than this one. I threw away multiple glomerular projection neurons. I'm not sure why I did it, but just to be more conservative. And then you get some basically statistical significance for the hypothesis. With in this case, the primacy number was 5. I mean, the p-value is not so dramatic as in response data. But at least it suggests that for us to look further. Also, this is the most conservative result, meaning that we normalize this matrix very extensively. You can see that, like for example, these Kenyan cells were recently born, so they have very few synapses, and there are a lot of confounding issues that you have to deal with, such as issues of normalization and sifting through the data. I don't question the data though, because I mean that's the only thing I have. If I start questioning it, yeah, but it was a single cell. It was a single Kenyan cell from one animal, right? Wow. So it's basically the shredder. And for the number of claws, I think they use like maybe 50 to 30% of claws from each Kenyan cell. So there are two shredders that the data go through. It's not really connection matrix in one animal. It's one Kenyan cell in one animal, right? And there. No, it completely destroys. It destroys the correlation. There's nothing yet to extrapolate, really. You know. So, I mean, this is one animal, right? So that's the significance. Although the animal is arguably Drosophila larva, so there is not much. But yes. So there is nothing. If you take like a connection matrix, and you take only one Kenyan cell from it, and then because Kenyan cells, you cannot align projection neurons between animals, but Kenyan cells are different between different animals, right? So it's like you take a connection matrix and you pull random lines from it, and then you build a new connection matrix. And it becomes like this type of correlations are destroyed. I guess I'd like to finish at this point and ask for questions, and thank you for attention and for generous support of ICTP and obviously organizers for giving us this opportunity to meet. Thank you.